We've all heard the statements and stats about the ominous timeline our planet is on. To avoid the worst effects of climate change, from natural disasters to mass extinction, we know that we need to reduce our greenhouse gas emissions, and fast. And when we stop literally lighting things on fire to power our world, we can build something that looks a little more like this. When you plug in, you're pulling from a resilient local network of abundant and affordable clean energy that keeps the sky blue, the storms at bay, and the birds, well, alive. So, how close are we to a zero emissions grid? Greenhouse gas emissions primarily come from electricity, transportation, and industry. But in a zero emissions future, this chart actually looks more like this. Because in a post-carbon world, almost everything relies on the electrical grid. This means we'll need a way bigger grid than we have today, maybe as much as double the 4,100 terawatt hours the US currently uses per year. Right now, that's served up through a high voltage power system that draws primarily from centralized coal, nuclear, and natural gas plants. Three main grids then deliver power by the minute to the eastern half, the western half, and the Texas half of the country through local distribution networks.
We use almost no oil in the power sector to generate electricity, which is a good thing. In 2017, we were 28% cleaner than we were back in 2005. Two-thirds of our power still comes from coal and natural gas, so we have a lot of work to do.
So what is that work exactly? Well, electrical engineers see the life cycle of energy in three main phases: generation, making it, transmission, moving it, and distribution, metering it out. And to build a zero emissions grid, each of these stages has to be clean and efficient. So let's start with generation.
If you look at how clean we are, nuclear makes up about 20%, hydro is around 7.5% or so, and then wind and solar are together getting close to around 8%, and then very small amounts of geothermal and some other renewable technologies.
So how can we bump those numbers up? The fact is, most renewable sources are highly variable, and finding a way to store that sunshine for a rainy day is challenge number one.
Often storage seems as a holy grail to allow us reaching a low carbon society. Solar PV and wind turbines are intermittent energy resources. If we need to have energy available all the time, they cannot supply it. Today, the most common and widely used technology to store energy is pump storage, huge dams with a large lake at the top. And when we need the energy, we just open the dam and water is running down and generating hydroelectricity.
Compressed air is another viable solution for underground storage. And then, of course, there are batteries, which are becoming cheaper and more widely available by the day.
With batteries, typically, you just have a few hours of storage. We're going to need longer periods of storage, not on the order of hours, but on the order of weeks.
The problem is pumped hydro storage, while powerful, has already been developed in most of the places it can be. It has a huge ecological footprint, and until material scientists crack the immortal battery, and don't worry, we'll let you know, renewables are just too flaky to rely on entirely without some additional help.
Nuclear power has been a very reliable source of zero emission power in the US. People like Bill Gates and some other groups are helping to provide support for development of advanced and small modular reactors. These are safer, cleaner, generate less waste than the generation of nuclear reactors that we have right now.
What we call carbon capture and storage that you install on a fossil fuels power plant, what it can do is capture the CO2 before it reaches the air. Then you put it back to the ground. This technology is not yet mature. It's very expensive, but this is definitely one of the tools and one of the technologies that we need to develop.
Of course, if we could just crack nuclear fusion, that would be another story. And maybe we will. But once we've generated all the clean energy we need, our next challenge is to transmit it. This is challenge number two, and as it turns out, it's one of the biggest.
There are some areas that are just more geographically endowed with good renewable resources. Places in Washington state create more hydropower than they actually use. So they have a high voltage direct current line from Oregon down to the suburbs of Los Angeles that deliver that clean energy to Southern California.
Unfortunately, large infrastructure projects like this are a challenge to move forward because, let's face it, no one wants a power line running through their view, and building them underground is a spendy endeavor.
You know, we need to bite the bullet. We're going to probably need tens or hundreds of large power lines constructed for this power grid of the future.
And putting up with some black lines in the sky seems like a fair price to pay to keep the whole sky blue. But even the most efficient power lines still lose some heat through transport. And that brings us to the final piece of the puzzle, distribution. Once the power gets where it's going, it has to be metered out to industrial, commercial, and residential consumers. And we're working hard to give many of these ancient systems a digital facelift. By learning about people's energy consumption habits, a so-called smart grid can actually adjust prices to keep up with supply and demand.
Energy efficiency should be promoted first. Any megawatt which is not consumed is a win-win here.
There are millions of smart meters that have been deployed throughout the US. And they'd get a signal, perhaps through their thermostat or from their smart device, that would tell them that prices are high right now and that they might want to hold off on doing the laundry or running the dishwasher during the peak time of day.
But what if that kind of communication went both ways? Generating and storing power locally, like using rooftop solar panels or electric car batteries, eliminates the need for transmission entirely. And this is a concept known as distributed generation, or a microgrid. Instead of pulling a set amount of power from a distant main source, microgrids allow custom power delivery from a suite of sources as close as your own neighborhood. And this turns its participants into prosumers, because they are both producing and consuming electricity. A device called a microgrid controller acts like a DJ, dropping live beats to match the energy of the crowd or the energy consumption of a neighborhood. And this allows prosumers to buy and sell cleaner electricity to and from their own individual power systems, saving time, dollars, and carbon.
A microgrid manager or controller, it knows what the weather forecast is for the day. It knows how much solar, you know, you're gonna be able to produce. It knows how much storage is available. It knows when to have the natural gas backup kick in. It knows what the power prices might be and when it can be selling power to the grid or buying power very cheaply from the main grid. And it can be optimized based on producing the fewest amount of greenhouse gases.
Some countries are getting close to a zero emissions grid. Iceland has so much hydropower that it sustains their entire nation.
Tackling climate change and reducing emissions is a global challenge. So even if California and Germany and all Europe become zero carbon, it doesn't matter if the whole world won't unify and act together to achieve this goal, because a molecule of carbon does not care if it was emitted in China or in Israel. It will impact the climate the same.
And that's not even counting the billion people in developing nations who are expected to become energy consumers in the next century. The truth is, energy is different everywhere. But what all of us need is a healthy mix of renewable and other zero emission sources, next generation storage solutions, more transmission lines, and less need for transmission at all. Namely, a smart distribution system that shows us exactly when and how all this energy is moving around, helping us save megawatts and dollars. Experts agree that we must make big strides before 2030 and reach complete carbon neutrality by 2050 to avoid the 1.5 degree threshold that spells climate chaos.
Currently, we are headed to 3.2 degrees Celsius warming. If we want 1.5 degrees Celsius, we need to do five times more.
We kids shouldn't have to do this. I wish that the adults would take their responsibility, but since no one's doing anything, we have to.
So, how close are we to a zero emissions grid?
We are not so close. Actually, we are not close at all. But we definitely have means and tools to accelerate this transition.
We're still emitting somewhere north of 50 gigatons of greenhouse gases every year. So we need to stabilize that
We can get there, but we need to do it faster. We must be more ambitious, put more effort, and think in the box, out of the box, underneath the box, on all the ways that we can promote this really, really important goal of low carbon society.
Brains, exoplanets, dark matter, miracle cures, giant woolly mammoths. Check out more How Close Are We on this playlist. Smash that subscribe button and let us know what we should investigate next in the comments down below. Thanks for watching.